Welcome to Trinity Rep Radio Theater. I'm Kurt Columbus.
And I'm Janice Duclos.
And with us in the studio are two more members of Trinity Rep's resident acting company, Barbara Meek and Rachel Warren. Welcome, everyone.
Thanks,
Thank
Kurt.
Thank you, Kurt.
In today's program, we'll share stories about mothers who are heroes to their kids. Now, Mother's Day is this weekend, Janice, and it's always nice to take mom out for a meal, but I actually have been doing a little research on Mother's Day, and I don't know if you knew this or our listeners know this, but Mother's Day was actually founded here in America as a response to the American Civil War. It was an extension of the peace movement in America in the 1870s, and it was only in the 20th century that it became a more personal thing. But I loved knowing that Mother's Day is somehow connected to a desire to have peace in the world. I think that really resonates with a lot of the stories that we've chosen today.
That's fantastic. You know, actually, I had thought that it was another one of those days that was invented by the greeting card company.
That's right.
And I was going to say, well, that's a good one.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I know. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. I mean, because we've all come to think of it as a greeting card holiday, but actually there's a lot more to it. So our program centerpiece is a story by Louise Erdrich called The Leap. But first, Janice, will you tell us a little bit about our shorter pieces?
Sure. We have several pieces, once again, from the Sun magazine section called Readers' Write. Mm-hmm. And in our first piece, read by Barbara Meek, a daughter sees her mother in a new light.
Karen's mom, Jan, startled us from sleep. "Wake up, girls. We have to hide." We shielded our eyes from the overhead light as Jan explained that we needed to go down to the basement. Her boyfriend, Rick, was drunk and thought she cheated on him, and he was on his way over. Clothed only in T-shirts and panties, Karen, Jan, and I hurried down the rickety stairs and stood barefoot on the cold concrete. In spite of my fear, I couldn't help but feel a little excited. I was 13, and Jan was the coolest of all my friends' moms. She smoked pot, went to rock concerts, and wore mini skirts and short shorts. This was as close as I had ever come to being in a movie of the week. We all jumped when Rick began beating violently on the back door and shouting, "Jan, open the door, goddammit!" Afraid he would break in, we decided to run up the stairs, out the front, and down the street to my house, where my mother was likely fast asleep. Just as I reached the top of the stairs, Rick's fist burst through the back door window. We stepped over the broken glass and dashed out of the house, looking over our shoulders to see if Rick was following. Well, in a matter of seconds, we were on my porch, banging and yelling for my mom to let us in. It's not often that a 13-year-old girl is grateful to see her mother, but when mine appeared wearing a tattered old nightgown, I wanted to kiss her. Just then, Rick's car pulled up to the curb in front of my house. My mom ushered us in, and Jan breathlessly explained. Rick knocked at the door, quietly this time, and my mom answered, while Jan, Karen, and I huddled on the couch. Rick was calm, but obviously drunk. "I just want to talk, Jan," he said. My mom stepped aside and let him in. But to this day, I'm not sure why she did. I suspect it was her propensity to be polite. Seeing Jan reignited Rick's rage. This big, bearded bear of a man traversed the width of the living room in a few leaps, grabbed Jan by the legs, and dragged her off the sofa and onto the floor. When my mom began to dial 911, Rick dropped Jan with a thud and put his finger on the button to disconnect the call. Rick and my mom stood there staring at one another. My mother was a full foot shorter and less than half his weight, but she seemed to grow taller and said, "Get your goddamn hands off my phone right now." Rick looked at my mother expressionless. Then tears welled up in his eyes. The police arrived at that moment, sirens blaring. It seemed that Rick had hit a few parked cars as he'd made his way down the street, and someone else had called 911. He walked out, sat down on the porch step to await his fate. As I drifted off to sleep that night in my own bed, I dreamed I was a warrior princess, heir to the throne of the warrior queen.
This is Trinity Rep Radio Theater, and in today's program we're talking about the many ways mothers are heroes, and we've just heard Barbara Meek beautifully reading a selection from the Sun Magazine's Reader's Write section. That's a great piece, Janice. I love Barbara manages, of course, to wring all of the humor out of it. You manage to get humor and pathos as any great actor would. I love that she says that that she talks about feeling like she's in a movie of the week, right?
Yes, yes.
And that idea of the cool mom. You remember when you were a kid, there was always the cool mom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which was not your mom or my mom, at least.
Absolutely not.
I don't remember her being cool, at least, right?
But my mother was cool.
Did you, Barbara?
I did. I think I did. She was very pretty and dressed well, had her own business, you know. I played piano.
And did you always think she was cool, even when you were
yes.
a teenager? Wow.
I think so.
Wow, you have a lucky mom.
I think I did, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, my mom didn't smoke pot or wear shorts or miniskirts.
No, she didn't do that. But
she was cool in her own way.
Yeah. Was she?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, my gosh.
She had a great sense of humor.
You had a cool mom.
Yeah.
You had a cool mom, Rachel.
My mom is extremely cool. Oh. But I don't know that I thought so when I was a kid. Right. I don't know if I did. My best friend Lori's mother was the cool mom for sure. She would tan. We'd go over to her house and she'd be sitting. She had one of those folded lawn chairs in the back on their brick patio, and she'd have like the thing around her face and all the suntan oil, and she was so tan and pretty.
Love that.
I thought she was glamorous.
Yeah. I guess I guess my mom was cool too.
How so?
Well, I just realized that all of the kids came to our house, and she would always make Kool-Aid and cookies and things, and she was very pretty, and all of my friends had a little crush on her. So, I mean, I guess I hadn't thought about my mom as being cool in a long time. Here we go.
But it's interesting.
My mother didn't cook and do those kind of things.
Uh-huh.
But she did travel and she did like music and took me to concerts and smelled good and wore nice custom-made face powder and furs and things. You know, I thought that was cool.
Yeah, that is cool.
I wanted to be like her.
Yeah. The thing about this cool mom, though, is that though she was perceived as cool by the kids, she was kind of leading a lifestyle that didn't sound like it was exactly great for her children.
And I love that the story ends with the daughter realizing that her own mom is powerful and cool, even though she's not up hot pot smoking chick in a trailer.
Let's it's a trade-off.
let's hear our next piece. Speaking of cool, in our next piece, a woman reflects on the price of cool.
When I was 13, every cool kid in school wore brown, six-eyed Doc Marten boots. The specifics were important. Black Docs meant you were goth. 12-eye docs meant you were weird, but brown 6-eye docs meant you were cool. I didn't own a pair because my parents couldn't afford them. The cheapest docs cost more than $100, and my parents had filed for bankruptcy due to medical bills. My mother hadn't bought herself a new pair of shoes in 6 years. I didn't ask for docs, but I must have talked about them because one Saturday morning, my mother woke me up early. "Get dressed," she said. "We're going to the mall." She took me straight to a trendy clothing store that carried docs in every color and size. "What size are you, 6?" she asked. "Yes," I said excitedly. If I had been a better kid, I would have demurred or at least promised to do extra chores. But my only thought was of how popular these shoes would make me. Never mind that I had a bad highlight job in my hair and my mother applied my makeup. I would be cool. I wore the shoes to school that Monday. No one even noticed. My life stayed exactly the same. Soon, every dork like me had a pair. I forgot about my docs until years later when I was in college and I saw a boy wearing a pair. By then, they were woefully out of style. The next time I called home, I asked my mother how she'd been able to afford the shoes. She hadn't eaten lunch for 3 months, she said. She had gone without a new coat. She'd kept the money under her mattress. The day she'd bought them, she remembered, I'd put them on and walked around the neighborhood with a powder compact in my pocket, as proud as could be. "You were so happy," she said. "You looked beautiful."
This is Trinity Rep Radio Theater, and in today's program, She's My Hero, we're talking about mothers. That was Janice Duclos with a story from the Sun magazine. Beautiful, beautiful.
Oh, the sacrifices some moms will make.
Oh, and I just love the way that you read that story, because I could tell when the young woman is thinking about being cool, there's just a different quality to how she sees the world. And then
me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then when she transforms as she gets older, she starts to ask questions about it and understands that her mom made a big sacrifice for her.
I remember when I was a young teen and I used to thumb through the Sears catalog.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the Sears catalog?
Oh, very well.
3 inches thick.
Yeah.
And there was a pink brocade bedspread. It was very expensive at the time, and it was just beautiful, and I just loved it. And about a month later, my mom came in the door with the bedspread. And my parents didn't make a whole lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And you knew that my mom had to, you know, cut corners in other areas, but she got me that bedspread.
Yeah. Yep. And somehow mothers are telepathic when you're young, or at least you think they are. And then years later, you realize the 8 million cues that you leave, right?
Yes. I mean, it's like the girl in the story. I didn't ask for them,
yeah,
but
you must have mentioned them.
I must have mentioned them. Yeah, yeah.
And then it doesn't. It ends up not mattering for long.
Yeah.
That it goes right out of style. And the idea that a kid has that there'll be some, it makes me think of Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, like these magic shoes that'll change your life, or, you know, but that it didn't matter to her for long. This huge sacrifice, but that moment that her mom got of seeing her walk around the neighborhood.
That's right. Right. The value of it was actually not in what she got, but what her mother got from it. So that the sacrifice gave something to her mother. It's really beautiful. I can't wait to read our main story, but we're going to take a short break. We'll come back and hear about a remarkable mother in Louise Erdrich's story, The Leap, after this short break. This is Trinity Rep Radio Theater. Stay with us.
You're listening to Trinity Rep Radio Theater on WRNI. Recorded live in WRNI studios and broadcasting the first full weekend of each month, actors from Trinity Repertory Company perform and discuss short stories, poetry, personal narratives, and excerpts from novels with Trinity Rep's artistic director, Kurt Columbus. If you would like to learn more about this program, we invite you to visit our website at WRNI.org. You can hear past programs online, or you can subscribe to the Trinity Rep Radio Theater podcast. It's all online at WRNI.org.
We're back with Trinity Rep Radio Theater, and today's show is about moms. I'm Kurt Columbus, and with me in the studio are Janice Duclos, Barbara Meek, and Rachel Warren. Today's show is She's My Hero, and we're sharing stories. In this part of the program, we present Louise Erdrich's story, The Leap, written in 1990.
Louise Erdrich is the award-winning author of The Beat Queen and Love Medicine. And here is Rachel Warren reading The Leap.
My mother is the surviving half of a blindfold trapeze act. Not a fact I think about much, even now that she is sightless, the result of encroaching and stubborn cataracts. She walks slowly through her house here in New Hampshire, lightly touching her way along walls and running her hands over knickknacks, books, the drift of a grown child's belongings and cast-offs. She has never upset an object, or as much as brushed a magazine onto the floor. She has never lost her balance or bumped into a closet door left carelessly open. It has occurred to me that the cat-like precision of her movements in old age might be the result of her early training, but she shows so little of the drama or flair one might expect from a performer that I tend to forget the flying Avalons. She has kept no sequin costume, No photographs, no flyers or posters from that part of her youth. I would, in fact, tend to think that all memory of double somersaults and heart-stopping catches had left her arms and legs, were it not for the fact that sometimes, as I sit sewing in the room of the rebuilt house in which I slept as a child, I hear the crackle, catch a whiff of smoke from the stove downstairs, and suddenly the room goes dark. The stitches burn beneath my fingers, and I am sewing with a needle of hot silver, a thread of fire. I owe her my existence 3 times. The first was when she saved herself. In the town square, a replica tent pole, cracked and splintered, now stands cast in concrete. It commemorates the disaster that put our town smack on the front page of the Boston and New York tabloids. It is from those old newspapers, now historical records, that I get my information. Not from my mother, Anna of the Flying Avalons, nor from any of her in-laws, nor certainly from the other half of her particular act, Harold Avalon, her first husband. In one news account, it says, "The day was mildly overcast, but nothing in the air or temperature gave any hint of the sudden force with which the deadly gale would strike." I have lived in the West, where you can see the weather coming for miles, and it is true that out here we are at something of a disadvantage. When extremes of temperature collide, a hot and cold front, winds generate instantaneously behind a hill and crash upon you without warning. That, I think, was the likely situation on that day in June. People probably commented on the pleasant air, grateful that no hot sun beat upon the striped tent that stretched over the entire center green. They bought their tickets and surrendered them in anticipation. They sat. They ate caramelized popcorn and roasted peanuts. There was time before the storm for 3 acts. The white Arabians of Ali Khazar rose on their hind legs and waltzed. The mysterious Bernie folded himself into a painted cracker tin, and the Lady of the Mists made herself appear and disappear in surprising places. As the clouds gathered outside, unnoticed, the ringmaster cracked his whip, shouted his introduction, and pointed to the ceiling of the tent where the flying Avalons were perched. They loved to drop gracefully from nowhere, like 2 sparkling birds, and blow kisses as they threw off their plumed helmets and high-collared capes. They laughed and flirted openly as they beat their way back up again on the trapeze bars. In the final vignette of their act, they actually would kiss in mid-air, pausing, almost hovering, as they swooped past one another. On the ground, between bows, Harry Avalon would skip quickly to the front rows and point out the smear of my mother's lipstick just off the edge of his mouth. They made a romantic pair, all right, especially in the blindfold sequence. That afternoon, as the anticipation increased, as Mr. and Mrs. Avalon tied sparkling strips of cloth onto each other's face, and as they puckered their lips in mock kisses, lips destined never again to meet, as one long, breathless article put it, the wind rose miles off, wrapped itself into a cone, and howled. There came a rumble of electrical energy, drowned out by the sudden roll of drums. One detail not mentioned by the press, perhaps unknown. Anna was pregnant at the time. 7 months and hardly showing, her stomach muscles were that strong. It seems incredible that she would work high above the ground when any fall could be so dangerous, but the explanation I know from watching her go blind is that my mother lives comfortably in extreme elements. She is one with the constant dark now, just as the air was her home, familiar to her, safe, before the storm that afternoon. From opposite ends of the tent, they waved, blind and smiling, to the crowd below. The ringmaster removed his hat and called for silence so that the 2 above could concentrate. They rubbed their hands in chalky powder. Then Harry launched himself and swung once, twice, in huge calibrated beats across space. He hung from his knees and on the third swing stretched wide his arms, held his hands out to receive his pregnant wife as she dove from her shining bar. It was while the two were in midair, their hands about to meet, that lightning struck the main pole and sizzled down the guy wires, filling the air with a blue radiance that Harry Avalon must certainly have seen through the cloth of his blindfold. As the tent buckled and the edifice toppled him forward, the swing continuing and not returning in its sweep, and Harry going down, down into the crowd with his last thought, perhaps just a prickle of surprise at his empty hands. My mother once said that I'd be amazed at how many things a person can do within the act of falling. Perhaps, at the time, she was teaching me to dive off a board at the town pool, for I associate the idea with midair somersaults. But I also think she meant that even in that awful, doomed second, one could think, for she certainly did. When her hands did not meet her husband's, my mother tore her blindfold away. As she swept past him on the wrong side, she could have grasped his ankle, the toe end of his tights, and gone down clutching him. Instead, she changed direction. Her body twisted toward a heavy wire, and she managed to hang on to the braided metal, still hot from the lightning strike. Her palms were burned so terribly that once healed, they bore no lines, only the blank scar tissue of a quieter future. She was lowered gently to the sawdust ring just underneath the dome of the canvas roof, which did not entirely settle, but was held up on one end and jabbed through, torn and still on fire in places from the giant spark, though rain and men's jackets soon put that out. Three people died. But except for her hands, my mother was not seriously harmed. Until an overeager rescuer broke her arm in extricating her, and also in the process collapsed a portion of the tent bearing a huge buckle that knocked her unconscious. She was taken to the town hospital, and there she must have hemorrhaged, for they kept her, confined to her bed, a month and a half before her baby was born, without life. Harry Avalon had wanted to be buried in the circus cemetery next to the original Avalon, his uncle, so she sent him back with his brothers. The child, however, is buried around the corner, beyond this house and just down the highway. Sometimes I used to walk there just to sit. She was a girl, but I rarely thought of her as a sister or even as a separate person, really. I suppose you could call it the egocentrism of a child, of all young children, but I considered her a less finished version of myself. It was during her confinement in the hospital that my mother met my father. He was called in to look at the set of her arm, which was complicated. He stayed sitting at her bedside, for he was something of an armchair traveler and had spent his war quietly at an Air Force training grounds, where he became a specialist in arms and legs broken during parachute training exercises. Anna Avalon had been to many of the places he longed to visit, Venice, Rome, Mexico, all through France and Spain. She had no family of her own and was taken in by the Avalons, trained to perform from a very young age. They toured Europe before the war, then based themselves in New York. She was illiterate. It was in the hospital that she finally learned to read and write, as a way of overcoming the boredom and depression of those weeks, and it was my father who insisted on teaching her. In return for stories of her adventures, he graded her first exercises. He bought her her first book, and over her bold letters, which the pale guides of the penmanship pads could not contain, they fell in love. I wonder if my father calculated the exchange he offered, one form of flight for another, For after that, and for as long as I can remember, my mother has never been without a book. Until now, that is. And it remains the greatest difficulty of her blindness. Since my father's recent death, there is no one to read to her, which is why I returned, in fact, from my failed life where the land is flat. I came home to read to my mother. To read out loud. To read long into the dark if I must. To read all night. Once my father and mother married, they moved onto the old farm he had inherited but didn't care much for. Though he'd been thinking of moving to a larger city, he settled down and broadened his practice here in this valley. It still seems odd to me, when they could have gone anywhere else, that they chose to stay in the town where the disaster had occurred, and which my father in the first place had found so constricting. It was my mother who insisted upon it, after her child did not survive. And then, too, she loved the sagging farmhouse, with its scrap of what was left of a vast acreage of woods and hidden hayfields that stretched to the game park. I owe my existence the second time, then, to the two of them and the hospital that brought them together. That is the debt we take for granted, since none of us asks for life. It's only once we have it that we hang on so dearly. I was 7 the year the house caught fire, probably from standing ash. It can rekindle, and my father, forgetful around the house and perpetually exhausted from night hours on call, often emptied what he thought were ashes from cold stoves into wooden or cardboard containers. The fire could have started from a flaming box, or perhaps a buildup of creosote inside the chimney was the culprit. It started right around the stove, and the heart of the house was gutted. The babysitter, fallen asleep in my father's den on the first floor, woke to find the stairway to my upstairs room cut off by flames. She used the phone, then ran outside to stand beneath my window. When my parents arrived, the town volunteers had drawn water from the fire pond and were spraying the outside of the house, preparing to go inside after me, not knowing at the time that there was only one staircase and that it was lost. On the other side of the house, the superannuated extension ladder broke in half. Perhaps the clatter of it falling against the walls woke me, for I had been asleep up to that point. As soon as I awakened in the small room that I now use for sewing, I smelled the smoke. I followed things by the letter then, was good at memorizing instructions, and so I did exactly what was taught in the second grade home fire drill. I got up, I touched the back of my door before opening it. Finding it hot, I left it closed and stuffed my rolled-up rug beneath the crack. I did not hide under my bed or crawl into my closet. I put on my flannel robe, and then I sat down to wait. Outside, my mother stood below my dark window and saw clearly that there was no rescue. Flames had pierced one side wall, and the glare of the fire lighted the massive limbs and trunk of the vigorous old elm that had probably been planted the year the house was built, 100 years ago at least. No leaf touched the wall, and just one thin branch scraped the roof. From below, it looked as though even a squirrel would have had trouble jumping from the tree onto the house, for the breadth of that small branch was no bigger than my mother's wrist. Standing there, beside Father, who was preparing to rush back around to the front of the house, my mother asked him to unzip her dress. When he wouldn't be bothered, she made him understand. He couldn't make his hands work, so she finally tore it off and stood there in her pearls and stockings. She directed one of the men to lean the broken half of the extension ladder up against the trunk of the tree. In surprise, he complied. She ascended. She vanished. Then she could be seen among the leafless branches of late November as she made her way up and along her stomach inched the length of a bough that curved above the branch that brushed the roof. Once there, swaying, she stood and balanced. There were plenty of people in the crowd and many who still remember or think they do. My mother's leap through the ice-dark air toward that thinnest extension, and how she broke the branch falling so that it cracked in her hands, cracked louder than the flames as she vaulted with it toward the edge of the roof, and how it hurtled down end over end without her, and their eyes went up again to see where she had flown. I didn't see her leap through air, only heard the sudden thump and looked out my window. She was hanging by the backs of her heels from the new gutter we had put in that year, and she was smiling. I was not surprised to see her. She was so matter-of-fact. She tapped on the window. I remember how she did it, too. It was the friendliest tap, a bit tentative, as if she were afraid she had arrived too early at a friend's house. Then she gestured at the latch, and when I opened the window, she told me to raise it wider and prop it up with a stick so I wouldn't crush her fingers. She swung down, caught the ledge, and crawled through the opening. Once she was in my room, I realized she had on only underclothing, a bra of the heavy-stitched cotton women used to wear, and step-in, lace-trimmed drawers. I remember feeling lightheaded, of course terribly relieved, and then embarrassed for her to be seen by the crowd undressed. I was still embarrassed as we flew out the window toward Earth, me in her lap, her toes pointed as we skimmed toward the painted target of the firefighter's net. I know that she's right. I knew it even then. As you fall, there is time to think. Curled as I was against her stomach, I was not startled by the cries of the crowd or the looming faces. The wind roared and beat its hot breath at our back. The flames whistled. I slowly wondered what would happen if we missed the circle or bounced out of it. Then I wrapped my hands around my mother's hands. I felt the brush of her lips and heard the beat of her heart in my ears, loud as thunder, long as the roll of drums.
We've been listening to The Leap by Louise Erdrich on Trinity Rep Radio Theater, read by Rachel Warren. Rachel, that was an extraordinary performance. So beautiful.
Thanks, guys.
We'll talk about the story and others after this short break.
You're listening to Trinity Rep Radio Theater on WRNI. Recorded live in WRNI studios and broadcasting the first full weekend of each month, actors from Trinity Repertory Company perform and discuss short stories, poetry, personal narratives, and excerpts from novels with Trinity Rep's artistic director, Kurt Columbus. If you would like to learn more about this program, we invite you to visit our website at WRNI.org. You can hear past programs online, or you can subscribe to the Trinity Rep Radio Theater podcast. It's all online at WRNI.org.
We're back with Trinity Rep Radio Theater. I'm Kirk Columbus with Janice Duclos, Rachel Warren, and Barbara Meek. On today's show, we're sharing stories about the mothers that we love and know, and we've just heard Rachel's performance of Louise Erdrich's story, The Leap. Wow, that was, I mean, Rachel, what an extraordinary performance.
Because, oh, you're kind.
No, actually, it's really interesting. There was a shape and a propulsion to everything that you were doing that really respected the story. I mean, the story is extraordinary in its construction, right?
The first several times we did it in rehearsal, I couldn't get through it.
Yeah, right.
It's just like, I read to my mother. I read to her all night long. It's beautiful. It's an incredible story.
And part of what happens, though, is it time jumps, right? And there are details that get thrown at you as you go through the story. I'm struck by the sense of suspense that you get, because you know she's going to end up blind in this farmhouse, but then the details of the circus and then being in the moment of the circus, right?
Yeah. I find that there are lots of little moments of surprise in there, too. Mm-hmm. And one of the most surprising to me the first time that I read it was when they talked about the pregnancy and how she was pregnant during the accident. And you thought it was going to be the author.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then it turns out that it wasn't.
Yeah, that she's 7 months pregnant and barely showing was the other.
There's a feat in itself. Yeah. Huh?
Barbara, you just rolled your eyes at that idea.
I auditioned for Adrian Hall when I was 7 months pregnant.
Is that right?
Trinity. Yeah. I was showing. Believe you me, it was bulging like crazy. He must have thought I was a lunatic.
He must not have thought you were too much of a
lunatic. Baby.
That's incredible. No, there's something interesting that having a child brings to your work, I think. Rachel, you're a new mother.
Yep. I don't know. I mean, I'm so sleep deprived still that I think time will tell what it brings to my work. I feel like sometimes it maybe takes something from it. It's awesome. It's so awesome, but it's a little bit. It really does feel like hanging by the backs of your heels some days.
Yeah,
you're
flying. Well, I love too in the story that she says it's the debt we take for granted.
Yeah.
Is that your parents decide to have you at all.
None of us asks for life. It's only once we have it we hang on so dearly.
Isn't that
awesome?
It's an extraordinary...
I think I love the most about this story is that she had this history, this glamorous, fantastic history as a trapeze artist. And then when the accident happens, she leaves it behind. We know she didn't keep any memento, nothing from
nothing.
This really brilliantly interesting thing. And she leaves it all behind and is happy to and wants to. But then the moment comes where, because of that past, which she has totally left behind, she's the only one capable of saving her baby. And it's so interesting to me that this idea that maybe nothing is lost, or nothing is wasted, that there are these things that maybe we want no part of, but we experience them and we learn something from them, and they end up being the thing that makes all the difference in our lives.
And that makes us who we are, because, she starts right at the beginning of the story with that description of her fingertips lightly touching the walls. Yeah. It's really great.
It's a beautiful story.
It's a beautiful story. I think, go ahead, Janice.
What strikes me most about this is that she actually is fortunate enough to get to know her mother as a person before she's gone. I find that so many people find that they didn't really know their parents, and they find out things about their past after they're gone. They might find a trunk full of mementos and say, "Oh my gosh, I never knew this. I never knew that. They never talked about this and that." And so many of us, I think, don't know our parents in that way because of that egocentric thing.
Yeah, the egocentrism of the child.
Yeah,
absolutely. Let's go on to our next story, Janice, because we have a couple more that we're reading. Another one from Readers, right?
Yes, we're going to hear Barbara Meek, and she is going to tell us the story of a woman who was seeking her birth mother.
I'd been adopted as a newborn, and the day I turned 18, I went to the county clerk's office and asked to see my adoption records. A clerk escorted me behind the closed door and proceeded to scold me, saying that my records were sealed and it was against the law to open them. "Your parents adopted you because they love you," she said. "Now go home and be content with that." But I believed I had a right to know the name of my biological mother, so I didn't give up. I lied to get the information I needed and discovered that she lived in the town where I had grown up and that she had no other children. Despite how determined I'd been to find her, it took me 10 years to get up the nerve to write her a letter, which she never answered. I waited a few more years and wrote her again. Nothing. A few years after that, I wrote a third and final letter, telling her it was all right that she didn't want to know me, but I'd appreciate it if she would send me her family medical history. Still, no reply. I decided to leave my birth mother alone, but whenever I visited my hometown, I would drive past her house, a small two-story on a tree-lined street. The front porch had been glassed in and was cluttered with knickknacks. One night, I saw her sitting on the porch reading. A lamp shining over her shoulder lit her face. I knew it was she because I had seen pictures of her in the newspaper years before. I parked in front of the house next door, got out, and went halfway up the neighbor's walk, careful to stay out of the circle of illumination from their outdoor light. I stood in the dark for a long time and watched my birth mother read. Then I stepped into the circle of light. Only a driveway and a pane of glass separated me from the woman who'd given birth to me. If she'd looked up, she would have seen me. But she didn't. I continued my drive-bys whenever I was home for a visit, but I never saw my birth mother again. After she died, her friends tracked me down. They had known of my existence until they'd found my letters stacked next to the reading chair on the glassed-in porch.
Barbara Meek with a story from the Sun magazine. That was a really... Yeah, it's a really interesting story, Janice, especially vis-a-vis what you just said before, this notion of knowing your parents, not knowing your parents. And, mm-hmm. you know, she just remains a mystery. And the letters are close to her, and the daughter knows that they're important to her. But it's an open question, isn't it?
Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, so many women give up children for adoption mm-hmm. for so many reasons. Mm-hmm. It was obvious that this woman had not really let go of her.
Yeah.
That she still had her letters.
Yeah.
So there was some pain involved with that. But then you think about the poor daughter who never heard any kind of a response.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you think, did she do the right thing or not?
Well, yeah. And Barbara, the mm-hmm. interesting thing about the way you read that story is that there's sadness, but then a sense of closure, too. I mean... Mm-hmm. She feels
like she did get the letters and she did read them.
Right.
Yeah.
And she kept them.
And she kept them. Mm-hmm. And she read them often.
Yeah. Oh, and, see, that's the detail that I think you've added in because it's not in the story, but that's.
I have friends who've. I have friends who've contacted birth parents, and I remember their decision, my friend's decision to write her father and how long it took her once she knew who he was to write him and how much was at stake in that letter, you know, and if she was going to hear back. I mean, in her story, she did hear back. But I think that must be, it's such an incredible thing to put yourself out there in that way, to reach out to somebody in
and
that
face
way.
Rejection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and then there's a kind of heroism it's hard to even talk about it this way, but I respect the birth mother
absolutely.
In this story too, right?
Absolutely.
For saying that you've had this other life and your parents are your parents, you know? So there's a heroism involved in that.
Absolutely. It's so complicated on every side and you can't know, but what I love, it made me think about the way Barbara read it was that in the end we make our own story about the why and take from it what we need, I think.
Yeah. Let's read one more, Janice. This is another selection from Readers' Write. It's about an unlikely hero.
I once worked as a counselor in a residential substance abuse treatment facility for adolescent boys in Colorado. When state budget cuts left us with empty beds, we began housing undocumented immigrant teens at the request of immigration authorities because minors couldn't be placed in adult detention centers. Typically, we would receive one or two Mexican boys and hold them for a night or two until they were deported. It must have been confusing, if not terrifying, for them to live among boys with emotional and substance abuse problems. I was the only one on staff who spoke any Spanish. One day, we received six Salvadoran boys who were a special case. They weren't being deported, but had to stay with us until some red tape regarding their parents' citizenship was sorted out. That first night, they called Virginia, Maryland, and New York to tell their relatives they were alive but stuck. I listened to them sound out the name of our town and realized they had no idea where it was. 2 days later, a small woman with dark eyes and worn but immaculate clothes knocked at our door and asked for one of the Salvadoran boys. She had hung up the phone in New York and bought a bus ticket to Colorado. She was shaking as she told me her son's name. I went and retrieved a boy of about 13. He had been loaned two big clothes, as the ones he'd arrived in had grown putrid from the hours he'd spent in the back of a barely ventilated truck with 20 other people. When the boy saw his mother, his brave face twisted like a small child's, and they clung to one another as if they were in danger of falling. She said over and over, "Mijo," my son. He blubbered, and she squeezed his face and arms and belly as if to prove to herself that he was flesh and blood in her arms. She told me she had not seen her son in 11 years. 11 years! When she'd left for the U.S., he'd been a little boy wobbling on uncertain legs. Now the teenager sitting beside her was wobbling from two nights spent walking across the Arizona desert. I wondered how a mother could have left her son. I wondered how bad her situation had been. By coincidence, I would soon travel to El Salvador, and when I got there, I would see. Devastating poverty and violent repression by an indifferent aristocratic government continued to drive many Salvadorans north to the U.S. 4 years later, I live in El Salvador and work toward a day when mothers don't have to leave their children.
This is Trinity Rep Radio Theater, and we've just heard Janice Duclos with a story from The Sun magazine. Incredibly powerful. I mean, it's devastating and beautiful. Because
it's so heartbreaking. I mean, talk about sacrifice.
Yeah. And bonds over time and distance, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that she literally gets the call, hangs up, and gets on a bus to go halfway across the country.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just an extraordinary story. And really basically sums up our theme, I think. That's great. We have one more story, but before we hear our last piece, we have some news to share with our longtime listeners. After our next broadcast in June, Trinity Rep Radio Theater will be on a production hiatus. Now, I think everyone realizes that these are challenging times up here in America and around the world, and nonprofit arts organizations and public radio stations are not exempt from the challenges. It's our goal to return with some new programs when the climate improves, but right now, Trinity Rep and WRNI are recognizing some of our other substantial fundraising priorities.
Now, you've told us that you enjoy listening to our show as much as we enjoy creating it and sharing it. But now, as we begin this hiatus, we need to hear your voices. So please send your comments, suggestions, and messages of support to Trinity Rep Radio Theater, WRNI, 1 Union Station, Providence, Rhode Island, 02903. Or you can email eatkinson@trinityrep.com. That's eatkinson@trinityrep.com.
Now, our archived programs will remain available for listening at wrni.org. So if you've missed any of those shows in the last 5 years, there are more than 30 of them. We hope that you'll enjoy them during our hiatus.
And be sure to join us for our next program, our last before the hiatus begins. We will celebrate the great storytelling that makes our show distinctive. Dramatic literature in conversation with our world. Please listen on June 3rd, 4th, and 5th.
We've heard a lot from daughters. Let's hear from a mom to close today's show. One last Reader's Write, read by Barbara Meek.
I'm saying goodbye to my daughter at the airport. Sasha is 10 and about to fly alone to Florida to visit her best friend. We lean into each other, forehead to forehead, Sasha looking fearless and anticipative, I misty-eyed and filled with awareness that this is but one of many separations to come. On the return trip, Sasha's plane makes an unscheduled stop. She calls to let me know that she has followed some other passengers to a new boarding area and will take a different plane home. I'm shaken and irate at the airline. My daughter is matter of fact. A decade later, Sasha calls me from the airport in Dusseldorf, Germany, where she is changing planes on a return flight from Greece. She's badly sunburned and has been waiting for hours. There's no information desk in sight, and Sasha has forgotten most of her high school German. I place a frantic call to her former pediatrician, who advises wet paper towels and plenty of fluids. I spend the night mothering Sasha long distance, running up an exorbitant phone bill. Another decade has passed, and my daughter is a scientist doing environmental field research in Costa Rica and Bolivia. She travels in and out of backcountry airstrips in aircraft the size of large dragonflies. I worry about plane crashes, poisonous snakes, killer bees, and political unrest. By phone, Sasha reassures me in her clear, calm voice. Vaya con Dios, I say as we hang up, thinking a Spanish blessing couldn't hurt. I will never be able to keep her safe. Never have been able to, really, even when she was an infant in my arms. My daughter's life, all life, is as fragile as a plane in flight, as a dragonfly's wings. I live in anticipation of our next airport reunion, when we'll lean into each other forehead to forehead, all distance erased. My daughter, return to me once more.
You've been listening to Trinity Rep Radio Theater, a production of WRNI and Trinity Repertory Company. Janice Duclos, director. Emily Atkinson and Janice Duclos, producers. Kurt Columbus, executive producer. Jim Moses, sound engineer. Joe O'Connor is WRNI's general manager. This program featured Janice Duclos, Barbara Meek, and Rachel Warren. The Leap by Louise Erdrich, published in Harper's March 1990, used with permission of the author, and the Wiley Agency. And pieces from the Sun magazine's Readers' Write section. Trinity Rep Radio Theater is broadcast the first weekend of every month on WRNI. You can hear this program again and find archived programs at WRNI.org. Thank you for listening, and please join us in June.